Was pretty wild. There were like No doubt in anyone's mind that Kenneka walks into this freezer, and the door shuts behind Kenneka. Now, there was a light in this freezer, but the light switch was outside, so when Kenneka walks in, and the door shuts behind her, it is pitch black. She can't see anything. While Kenneka is stumbling around, locked in a freezer, her friends have been searching all over the hotel for her, trying to find her, but they have no luck. They decide to call her mom between 4 and 4:30 a.m. to let her know that, like, they can't find Kenneka, and to see if maybe Kenneka somehow ended up at home. But when they find out that she had not gone home, they continue searching the hotel. They're asking the front desk attendant, and they even go down the stairs where Kenneka was looking for her. This isn't a case which I sometimes cover, where people get drunk and separated from their friends, and their friends just leave. These girls were searching this hotel for her. They were not gonna leave without her. Plus, they have her wallet, they have her keys, they have her phone. They know she isn't really gonna be able to get by without those things. Leave the hotel at 4:30 a.m. and they look outside. They're like searching outside the hotel now. And then they come back in, and more people from the party are joining in this search for Kenneka. Okay, so remember how Kenneka and her friends had driven to this hotel in Kenneka's mother's car? Mother's name is Teresa. Well, Teresa knows that Kenneka is missing, and at one point she picks up the phone to try to call her daughter because she is freaking out, and the phone is answered by Kenneka's friends, and they're like, yeah, we have all of her stuff. So Teresa realizes she has no way of getting a hold of her daughter, and she is just panicking. Security footage would capture the girls running out into the parking lot and getting into Teresa's car. They drive to Kenneka's house, and they pick up Teresa and bring her back to the hotel so she can help search for her daughter. Teresa would later say that she felt like Kenneka's friends were hiding something, but she didn't know what it was. She could tell that they had been drinking and that they were also possibly high. So she asks them, hey, is Kenneka drunk? And they tell her that Kenneka had had just one drink. Kenneka's mother said that she didn't handle her alcohol very well, and that even one drink would be too much for her. So they go to the front desk and they ask for help, and they kind of just blow them off. Teresa's like, I need to see security footage. I need to figure out where my daughter went. And they're like, look, only police can come in and demand to look at our security. So they end up searching the hotel for like another hour or so, but there is no sign of Kenneka. At 7:15 a.m., Teresa calls 911 about her missing daughter, and dispatch basically says, look, she's a teenager, she's out drinking, she's probably passed out drunk somewhere in that hotel. He's like, go home, relax, I'm sure your daughter will show up. But Teresa's friends and family did not go has had enough. This is like too much. So they call police. And when police show up, they learn about this missing girl. And this is when the police officers ask the hotel. I'm not sure if it was just like a hotel staff or the hotel security to look through the footage so they can see where Kenneka went. But then the police leave because there's like hours and hours of footage to go through at this point. The next day, Kenneka was officially reported missing and police began their investigation. This investigation didn't begin until 1:15 the next day, so September 9th. The hotel staff claimed that they looked on all of the security footage, but they couldn't really see anything. Police searched the hotel and surrounding areas, but found nothing. It wasn't until around 10 p.m. that night when an officer decided to look back through the security tapes, and this is when he finds Kenneka stumbling through the hallways in the lower levels of the hotel around 3:20 a.m. He can tell just by looking at this footage that Kenneka is so out of it. She's running into the walls. She has this very confused look on her face. So, police send out a search team to look for her and try to follow her last known steps. And this last known footage shows her walking through the kitchen towards the double freezer. So the hotel has two kitchens, and I guess this one was like under renovation. It wasn't being used very much, but the freezer was still on and it was still running. And it was a 34 degrees Fahrenheit, and when the door was shut, it was just complete darkness. Kenneka was found at 1 a.m. on September 10th, 2017, dead inside the freezer. She was found lying on the floor, face down, her hair, which had been straightened before she left that night, was now curly and messy. She was also found with one shoe off. She had been wearing ripped jeans, a crop top, jean jacket, and a white bra. Her body was frozen solid. Police take Teresa into a room in the hotel to notify her about the fact that her daughter's body has been found, and there is this heartbreaking footage from the hotel. They take her in a room, and seconds later, you can see Teresa running, screaming from the room. She runs out of the hotel, but eventually she's brought back into the hotel because she has to ID her daughter's body. She later leaves the hotel and stands outside where she does a Facebook Live telling everyone that her baby is dead. She said that Kenneka's body was found inside the freezer of the hotel, and she says at the end of this, quote, "For the record, ain't nobody did nothing to her," end quote. And no foul play is suspected by the police. The autopsy revealed that Kenneka had died from hypothermia. She had some scratches and wounds on her foot and ankle that were the ones that were exposed that she didn't have a shoe on. But other than that, there were no other wounds or markings of any kind on her body. No signs of a struggle or that she had been in a fight. Her toxicology report came back showing prescription drug in her system that her mother said she had not been prescribed, and it was topiramate, which is a drug used for epilepsy or to prevent migraines. It can also be used to lose weight and control muscle spasms. According to WebMD, side effects of this drug include drowsiness, loss of coordination, confusion, slow thinking, trouble paying attention, and memory problems. And the use of alcohol would worsen these effects. Kenneka's death was ruled an accident. Her mother and friends have later said that they believe otherwise and that they think foul play was involved. Kenneka's mom would do this interview where she said that there was something up with her daughter's death. She said that when Kenneka was found, her shirt was pulled up and her shoe was off, and that this was very suspicious. She also pointed out that the medication found in Kenneka's system wasn't prescribed to her, and that she believed her daughter had been drugged at the party. However, during the autopsy, this drug that was found in Kenneka's body showed prolonged use, so she hadn't been drugged that night. It had built up in her system over time. Now Kenneka's 19. She could have gone to a doctor without her mother knowing and gotten this. Another thing that came to my mind when I heard it could be used for weight loss is maybe she bought it like on the black market or just from somebody else, because a lot of 19-year-old girls are concerned with their weight. Okay, so remember how Kenneka's friends had ended up with her phone that night? Well, when they went to pick up her mother, they had given Kenneka's phone to Teresa. And after Kenneka's body was found, her mother was asked several times by police if they could have that phone and look through it. But Teresa refused, saying she had already looked through it. There was nothing on there that had anything to do with her daughter's death. And it was like something of her daughter she wanted. She didn't want it to sit in an evidence box for, you know, however long. This case reminds me a lot of the Gabby Petito case, in how the media got so involved with it and people just started coming up with all kinds of theories. That is what happened in Gabby's case, and that is exactly what happened in Kenneka's case. And there are a lot of theories floating around about this case. I will talk about a couple that I found online. So one popular theory is that her friends had something to do with her death. This theory goes that Kenneka's friends sold her to be sexually assaulted and killed by someone or multiple people at the party. Okay, so remember the Facebook Live I talked about when they first got to the party and the girl with the mirrored glasses? Well, some people like zoomed in on the mirrored glasses. They were like watching what was happening in front of the girl as she was Facebook Living behind her. And there's also people who claimed to have cleaned up the audio from this Facebook Live, and they are saying that Kenneka can be heard saying, "Help me." Some people believe that Kenneka was killed somewhere else and then left in the freezer, but the security footage really does disprove this theory. During her autopsy, there was no evidence that Kenneka had been sexually assaulted, and her friends looked for her for hours. I do not think they just sold her to be sexually assaulted. Another theory says that the hotel had something to do with her death, and the R ending up in the freezer was a cover-up. These people say that she was lured into this freezer by someone working at the hotel, and then she was purposefully locked inside. Another idea that kind of ties to this one is that she was killed off camera, transferred into a garbage bag, and then put in the freezer and dumped. And then it looked like she had just stumbled into the freezer, but really she was killed like in another part of the kitchen by a worker, and then they put her in the freezer because we do not have, like, there was no camera facing that portion of the kitchen, so no one knows what happened in that kitchen. So that's just another theory. The last theory I want to talk about says that the video evidence was tampered with and that someone had been following her the entire time while she was stumbling around the hotel, and then an employee edited it so that it looked like she was just stumbling around alone. They say this was why the hotel refused to pull up the footage for the mother when she arrived, and why they told police they found nothing suspicious on the footage when they had looked through it. The hotel didn't want to have, like, any bad publicity for having a murder happen, so they tried to cover it up. And while the hotel probably didn't want bad publicity, I think it's hard to believe that they went through and edited out somebody following her. Plus, if you watch this footage, it seems like she's alone and trying to find someone, anyone really, to help her. I don't think anyone's following her. In 2018, the family filed a $50 million lawsuit against the Crown Plaza Hotel for the daughter's death. Teresa claims that the hotel was neglectful for not properly securing the renovated area and locking it off from the public. She also blames the hotel for not doing anything to stop or end the party that had at least 30 people in a room made or intended for just 4 people. There had been a noise complaint that night. The hotel obviously knew there was a party going on, but the staff did nothing about it. The lawsuit goes on to say that staff members were neglectful in not allowing Teresa to view the security footage to help find her daughter, or for having a security officer look through the tapes for her. Like, if there was a confidentiality or something where they didn't want just some random civilian looking through their tapes, they should have immediately had a security officer looking through them. She said that had the staff helped her when she asked for it, they could have found her daughter sooner. And I agree with that. I think had they been looking at the tapes as soon as Kenneka was missing, first of all, they wouldn't have had hours and hours of footage to look through. They would have had, like, maybe a half hour or an hour, and maybe they could have gotten to Kenneka in time. So, in my opinion, I think this was just a horrible accident. I think Kenneka got drunk, and I think she wandered into the freezer, and she was trapped, and that's awful, but I don't think foul play was involved. And I get why her mom does, or not really why her mom does, but why her mom wants to think someone is responsible, because her daughter died and she doesn't want want it to be her daughter's fault. I'm not saying it's completely Kenneka's fault. But I do think that, like, when you are that intoxicated, sometimes accidents happen. It's unfortunate that Kenneka left her stuff in the room to begin with. It's also very unfortunate because she was so drunk that not one of her friends stayed with her. The three of them left to go get her phone and keys and left her in the hall. And this is not their fault. But I wish one of them would have stayed with her. Anyway, I want to know what you guys think about this case. Do you think it was an accident? Do you think there's foul play? Whenever I put cases out there like this, I always get a lot of really good comments, really good theories, things that I haven't thought about. So I love when you guys leave your theories or what you guys think happened in the comments. I am going to quickly cite my sources. So Grayhew Investigates did such a good job. Like, he broke this case down so thoroughly. So if you want more information, check him out for sure. I got a ton of information from him. I got information from the Chicago Tribune article by Kate Thayer titled "Kenneka Jenkins' Family on the Dr. Oz Show Raises Doubt About Death." Another Chicago Tribune article titled "Kenneka Jenkins' Freezer Death Comes into Focus with Audio Video Police Reports." DistrictCity.com article by Chrissy Bobick titled "Kenneka Jenkins' Tragic Death." Soapboxy.com had an article by Jade Hassenblug titled "Kenneka Jenkins, What Really Happened?" And I also got information from WebMD and Wikipedia. Thank you guys so, so much for joining me for another Mystery Monday. Please check out my Patreon. This would definitely be the month if you're, like, on the fence about choice. Would be the month to do it. I usually do at least 3 videos a month. Most months I do 4. I just held up a 5 and said 4. I do 4. But this month it's 12, so it's like 3 months worth of videos. Plus you get access to all the old ones. Anyway, I hope you guys will join us over there. Again, that starts this Wednesday, the 20th. And make sure and check out the link for the coldest water in the description box.